Welcome back. We gather now here to continue our reflections for the fifth Sunday of Lent and the final one of the three scrutiny readings. We have a great excitement in our parish this year because we have so many people who are coming into the church this year. We have almost 20, and actually next year we're anticipating almost 10 now. We had a new one come today. And maybe even one of her children will join that group too. So wonderful blessings abound. It's always a good sign when we see people who are desiring to become Catholic, and we're very grateful. But these readings are always options for pastors and preachers to choose any year, and it has been my custom to always do the scrutiny readings, the year A readings in Lent, since they're so foundational and they help me so much. I know that other people feel very strongly against that, saying, well, you never hear the other readings ever, and I said, but these ones have a special importance, and if it had been up to me when I was I wasn't born yet, when they were revising the liturgy, I would have said these are not optional, these have to be done in Lent. But they didn't ask and I wasn't born, so there you go. But I feel strongly about them is the point. And I think when we talk today about Lazarus and kind of wrap these three readings, the reflection on these three readings up, you'll understand why. But since the raising of Lazarus is such a long reading, we're going to read the second reading, which was the letter of St. Paul to the Romans, and then we'll talk about the raising of Lazarus a little bit in the context of that reading. So Amy's going to go ahead.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, those who are in the flesh cannot please God, but you are not in the flesh. On the contrary, you are in the Spirit, if only the Spirit of God dwells in you. Whoever does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, although the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is alive because of righteousness. If the Spirit of the one who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, the one who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also, through his Spirit dwelling in you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. So from some of Paul's letters and some of the philosophical things that were happening around the time in the culture, the Greek culture, at the time that these were written and were being thought up, we end up with a couple of errors. And one is we end up with a strict separation between spirit and flesh or body. And in some sense, you'll hear people very intelligently get this wrong. And it's a thousands of year old error. And you hear about it now, and you hear people talking about it being what it means to be embodied, what it means to be, and all of these things, and how we interface with the world up into the 19th century. Schopenhauer talks about what this means, and all these different philosophers. It's a huge philosophical problem. And the error is that they're separate things. We can talk about the spirit, we can talk about the body, but the union of those things, the integrity of body and spirit is what we come to as Christian people, that it's united in us, that the body and the spirit are linked, which is why in our funeral rites and in one of the prayers it says, we will take on a body patterned after your glorious body. We refer to the glorious body. We deal with the body of Christ ascending and being seated at the right hand of the Father. It's not a spiritual ascension. It's a bodily ascension, so that the human nature itself resides in heaven. And that's why heaven has been opened for us in those what we call the Paschal mysteries, with the Easter mysteries, that has been opened for us because God descends down and gives us his divine self in Jesus Christ in his birth, and then in his life he teaches, and then he takes back something he gained by becoming human, which is our human nature, so that we can be with him. Opens the whole channel between heaven and earth so that they're commingled now. And that is a huge, amazing thought. And some of you are thinking, I'm not being clear enough. And then the other people are thinking, yeah, what's it matter? That, okay, fine, but what does it matter? And there's probably truth on both of those things, but it's helpful to understand that this thing about the body is, it becomes one thing. My body and my spirit are not separated. I happen to have a little bit of what might be a head cold or a little sinus congestion today. My body doesn't feel good, so I'm spiritually off too, I notice. You know, did I preach as well? Did I preach the same way as I would have if I'd felt fine? These are all questions that might occur to you when you're dealing with somebody who has an integrity of spirit and body and mind and all of those things. Things that make us human, that make us human, that we're brought together. When we have our body, our spirits are not ever really essentially separated from our body. Now, that's what I'm saying is that when you think of a person, you think of how wonderful they are, but you understand that our bodies are linked. You always remember what a person looked like, no matter how many years ago they died. You always remember their body, even though their spiritual self has been gone to the mercy of God, okay? And our belief is that they come back together. All right, long-winded and everything, but we got that. So, for Lazarus to have died, with which this reading is, by which this reading is followed by that reading, and Martha shows absolute confidence in Jesus, says, even though he's died, we may be, he may come back. God will give you even now what you ask of him, if you ask. And then he asks, do you believe? And it's the third time in the last 3 weeks now that he's asked somebody, do you believe? Or some arrangement of that. The woman at the well says, I know that the Christ is coming. And then Jesus offers the confession, I am he, the one speaking with you. And in the healing of the man born blind, he says, do you believe in the Son of Man? And he goes, who in this a Son of Man? And the man born blind responds with a great question, who is you, Lord, that I might may believe in him, that I may believe in him? He goes, it's me, the one speaking with you. And then it's this week, it's a conversation with Martha, saying, I do believe, Lord, that you are the one coming into the world, that you can do this. And it's these great confessions of belief that make it a strong parallel to baptism. When you believe, when you say, I believe, and you receive baptism, you receive something that you cannot receive otherwise. You receive eternal life, the fullness of divine life in the shirt, in your body, in your spirit, in yourself, in your whole self. You receive it. And that is something that is just wonderful. Now, I've said this before, and I don't believe it's possible to overstate it, but when Lazarus comes out of the tomb, Jesus says, untie him and let him go. Untie him and let him go. He's wearing these linen bands that he was buried in 4 days earlier. And the significance of that is that he treats death like a prison. Sin does not necessarily lead to death anymore. It's been broken. And that is an ancient, old, old, old concept. Predates religion by eons. I mean, time immemorial. You can understand the first humans probably came up with rules as a way to protect people's lives, for them to preserve their life. Life was much, much, much shorter than it is now. I would have been a very ancient person in the earliest generations of human beings. Already at my, well, I won't tell you how old I am. Amy knows, though, because we're born the same year. She's older than me, though. You know, so we life was short, and there was probably a very strong preciousness attached to it. Be careful, because there was no hospitals, there was no medical care, there was only what you could do on the spot to save somebody's life, and infections, and disease. There was no help for you. We had this. So, death that could be avoided was by saying, "Don't do this." And why not do this? Because we don't want you to die. So law comes into existence probably, and I've never met a philosophy of law student. If anybody knows one, or a professor, tell them to call me, because I made this up, and I'm just thinking of it myself, you know, that it was probably, I actually know there's other philosophers who've talked about this a little bit, but the idea is that early human beings have a concept of law that involves, if you do this, your life will be shortened. If you do this, you'll be injured or die. So the law becomes attached to death immediately in human history, as soon as law is developed. Don't do this or you'll die. And it has to be this way. I can't see that there's, it seems very reasonable to you, right? That law comes in to protect your life immediately, and it's attached, the breaking of the law is attached to death, not because it's a punishment, but it's a natural consequence of breaking the law. And the law develops continually, even till now, with this idea attached to it, that punishment comes out into the law out of a concept of your life needs to be lessened so that it can be fulfilled, so that it can be, you know, we need to teach you a lesson here, take away some of your rights, some of your things in punishment of the law, so that others may live, and perhaps in some places to keep others safety, but also maybe to keep yourself healthy and safe, and hopefully to be rehabilitated and things like that. When we impose some kind of restrictive jail-like punishment on somebody, that there's some good that comes out of it, but it still goes back to the protection of life. So we remember that. So from time immemorial, that was the case. Jesus comes along, and he does all kinds of healings, and he gets criticized for some of them, and then he says, today, untie him and let him go. Death no longer is necessarily connected with the breaking of the law, with the law in Jesus Christ. So people will say, you know, after 2,000 years, you'd think we understand it, this idea. And I would say, well, after the millennia, you know, multiple millennia before, since the dawn of human history and civilization, we've been dealing with the fact that these things are attached together. And they still are. Except now, in Jesus Christ, they don't have to be. Sin does not have to lead to death. And therefore, we come to this great understanding that in order for us to have life, Jesus Christ must release us from sin. If we are to live, sin has to be forgiven, which is why he offers himself on the cross for us. It is not solely for the purpose of the forgiveness of sins that Jesus has come, but he comes and sins are forgiven so that we might live in that divine life and, interestingly enough, be made one. And at the beginning of this talk today, I said, may we be made one, may our bodies, may we have an integrity of body and spirit, may we be unified, may we be principled, and he says, to do that, you must love one another, and when we love, we gain our principle. So we pray that our leaders in the world love the church, our church leaders, that they love their nations, that they love the people enough that they won't bring harm to them, that they love their neighbors, that they won't, you know, continue to invade them and things like that. That we, as a culture in the United States, wherever you are, might have a leadership that is principled on care for each other and for one another. And may that be our prayer, especially for our own politicians. But that we might become principled, and that we might, by being principled and loving, gain eternal life and be released from the curse of the law, which is death. So we offer you that, and we say thank you for joining us for these. Well, we've been doing these for a few years now. We think we're going to change our format here a little bit at some point. I'm promising that now, but maybe a year from now we'll actually do it, but we'll see what happens. But we are always grateful that you join us for these things, and if you like them, please share them and pass them around. And there you go. Thank you.